Lord, we thank you that, Lord, you've given us instructions, guidance, direction through your word. But, Lord, you reveal yourself to us through your word. And we're thankful, Lord, that we can know you as we hear the word of God preach, as we study the word of God, as we read the word of God. Lord, we can know you in a more personal way. We thank you, Lord. We do pray that you would bless us this evening. Bless the preaching of your word as we continue singing. I would just pray that our voices lifted up to you would just bring a worship to you, Lord, as we lift our hearts in praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Real quick, a couple of announcements. Don't forget, again, you already know, VBS starts tomorrow. Pastor, do we have any additional announcements? No? Okay, good. So VBS starts tomorrow. Okay. Hopefully, if you're working, hopefully you are working and you'll be here tomorrow, bright and early, ready to go, get plenty of rest tonight, drink lots of coffee, get one of those espresso shots or two in there, whatever you need, and be ready to go, because I'm sure the kids will be ready to go. And so we're excited. We have a lot of kids already pre-registered, so we're excited. So that is this week, Monday to Friday, 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. for the kids. Workers, obviously, you need to be here a little bit earlier. Let's see what else we got going on. Couples retreat, October the 12th through the 14th. Please get registered and signed up for that. That is down in Burtonham, Pennsylvania this year. Pastor Derek and his wife Katie Suttles will be speaking. Cost is in your bulletin. If you have any questions, please make sure you check with the office and they can direct you with that. So please get signed up. It's a great time of instruction. It's a great time to get away, have some good food, great fellowship, and just get some practical instruction for our homes, for our marriages. So that's October 12th, 13th, and the 14th of October. And that is pretty much all we have. Let us stand. Let's sing to hymn number 705. Take the name of Jesus with you. And that's what we're doing this week. We're telling the kids about Jesus. All that verse. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, that when we lift up our voices, Lord, Lord, in worship, praise, whether it's a need, or Lord, just petitioning or interceding for others, Lord, you hear us. Lord, you answer our prayers, and we thank you, Lord. Lord, we do pray that as we give this offering to you, Lord, that it would be done with a heart of love and worship to you, and Lord, that it would just be a reflection of our love for you, how you've blessed us so, and Lord, to give right to you what's rightfully yours. Bless this offering now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Acts. Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9. We're going to begin reading in verse 17. Share a message entitled The Power of the Gospel. And EBS starts tomorrow. And what's going to make a difference in these children's lives and their parents' lives is the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 9, we read of the conversion of the Apostle Paul and his starting out in ministry and connecting with other believers in the church. And so Acts chapter 9 and verse 17. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes, as it had been, scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose and was baptized. And when he received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogue, that he is the Son of God. But all that heard him were amazed and said, Is not this he that destroyed them which called on the name, on this name in Jerusalem, and came hither for that intent, that he might bring them bound unto the chief priests? But Saul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. And after that many days were filled, the Jews took counsel to kill him. But their laying away was known of Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. Then the disciples took him by night and led him down by the wall in a basket. And when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples. But they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way, and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus Christ. And as he was with them, coming in and going out at Jerusalem, and he spake boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus, and disputed against the Grecians, but they were about to slay him, which, when the brethren knew, they brought him down to Caesarea, and sent him forth to Tarsus. Then had the churches rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified, and walking in the fear of the Lord, and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, were multiplied. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to be together tonight, for BBS starting tomorrow. I pray, Lord, that you would give us great liberty to teach and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ all week long, and that our children that are coming and parents that are coming would be aware of the gospel, they would understand the power of God to save, and multitudes of them would get saved, Lord. And we're asking you to move in a special way, believe that all things are possible to him that believeth. I pray for this service tonight that we might understand the impact of the gospel message, the impact of Jesus Christ on the Apostle Paul, that extended through Paul upon multitudes of people who came to faith in Christ and churches that were established. And so, Lord, speak to us in a special way. We'll give you praise and glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Our text verse is verse 17. It says, And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. The power of the gospel. Jesus Christ is the gospel. The Apostle Paul recorded for us in 1 Corinthians 15 that the gospel message is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul on the Damascus Road came in contact with the resurrected Savior. And earlier in Acts chapter 9, you read in verse 4, it says, "And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And so Jesus Christ rose out of the grave. He died, was buried, and he rose again. And he meets the Apostle Paul on the Damascus Road, and he confronts him about his sin. And Paul believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is saved and never to be the same again. I think that's why Paul would write in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." The gospel message, the encounter of seeing a resurrected Savior, impacted Paul so greatly that it changed, completely changed his whole life. And the gospel message impacts us. It'll impact others. All we need to do is tell people that Jesus Christ came into this world, he died, and he was buried, and he rose again.
Amen.
And you can have salvation from the Lord above if you just believe and trust that gospel message. And so knowing this, the power of the gospel to change. Paul, it's amazing how, as you read through chapter 9, the statements of fear that people had in reference to who Paul was. He was not a kind man. He was not a gentle man. But rather, he was a man that had authority and power to throw Christians into jail and literally take their life from them. But the gospel impacted him in a great way. I like what George Whitefield said. George Whitefield said, "We preach the gospel of Christ no farther than we have experienced the power of it in our own hearts." And you know, Paul experienced the power of the gospel of Christ in such a way that it absolutely revolutionized his life.
Amen.
And gave him a spirit of boldness and grace and mercy to preach and teach who Jesus Christ is. How powerful has the gospel of Christ impacted your life? We can't help people know the power of God if we're not experiencing it ourselves. We can't tell people that Jesus Christ can change their life if we have no life to present to them how he changed us. And so Paul would preach a message based on the impact of a resurrected Savior on the Damascus Road. Not only that, but I like what Charles Spurgeon said. Charles Spurgeon said this: "The heart of the gospel is redemption. And the essence of redemption is the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ." And so the heart of the gospel is the redemption of God. We want to present to the children and to their parents all week long, as we have the opportunity, that they can be redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
They can be saved and forgiven of all their sin because Christ died in their place. He took all their sin upon himself, as he did taking our sin upon himself, so that we might be delivered, that we might be set free. And that's what Paul experienced as he came in contact with Jesus Christ on the Damascus Road. I see several things here. First of all, the power of the gospel. I see there was a spiritual experience that Paul had. Notice in verse 17, says Ananias went his way and entered in the house, and putting his hands on him, says, "Brother Saul, the Lord even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou comest hath sent me that thou mightst receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost." And so notice there is a fullness of the Holy Spirit. He had a spiritual experience of being filled with the Spirit of God. You know, without the Spirit of God, Paul would write that if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're none of his.
Amen.
And so we must experience a conviction that comes from the Spirit of God. You know, Jesus said when the Comforter would come, that he would reprove the world of sin. It is the Holy Spirit that brings conviction on people.
Amen.
And brings conversion in their heart. And so Paul was challenged to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. In Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, Paul says, "Be not drunk with wine wherein in is excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit."
Hey.
It literally means to be absolutely controlled by the Spirit of God. When you think about your life, who's directing your life? Who's controlling you? Who is guiding and directing you and strengthening you to live your Christian life? It is the Spirit of God that is within us. And so the fullness of the Spirit, every Christian needs to experience the fullness of the Spirit of God. And I'm not talking about a second blessing, and I'm not talking about some charismatic experience. I'm talking about there is an awareness in our hearts every day, daily, throughout the day, an awareness of the conviction of God on us that can only come not by our physical or mental understanding, but by a move of the Spirit of God within us. And so the spiritual experience of experiencing the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Not only was he challenged to have the fullness of the Holy Spirit, but he was challenged to be fully surrendered to God. Notice in verse 18, where we looked at in Acts 9, says, "And immediately there fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples, which were at Damascus." We see that because he was fully surrendered unto the Lord, that he had no problem with being baptized. We see that because he was fully surrendered unto the Lord, that he had no problem with connecting with the disciples that were at Damascus and staying with them and interacting with them. He was completely, fully surrendered. In Acts chapter 20, in verse 24, Paul would say this, "But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus," and here it is, "to testify the gospel of the grace of God." As we saw, we're going to be making comments as we go through chapter 9 of Acts, Paul's conversion did not thrill everybody. I mean, the believers were not thrilled about it because they didn't trust him. The unbelievers were not thrilled about it because he was impacting other people's lives with the gospel of Christ. And so they sought ways to destroy him and to kill him. They longed to end his influence on others. And so, but in this situation, Paul was fully surrendered. "None of these things moved me." You know, when you live your Christian life, there's a lot of things that can happen in your Christian life. There's a lot of opposition. There's a lot of difficult times. There's a lot of disappointments. But yet, wait a minute, if we're fully surrendered to the Lord, none of these things that come in up in our life will cause us to turn and go away from the leading of the Spirit of God in our life. All these things that Paul would face, the Spirit of God would continue to direct him to preach a full, clear gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul had no problem with doing that because of the fact that he was fully surrendered. And I thought it was interesting. I don't get the quote completely, but I read a little thing the other day. It said this, that now I'm just starting to lose it. Amen. But it said this, that, oh my goodness gracious, it's gone. And it was saying something in reference to the fact that wouldn't it be nice that going to church kept us from being involved in all these worldly activities instead of the worldly activities keep us from going to church.
Amen.
And I read through that. I thought, boy, that's pretty good. I like that thought. And how will that take place in our life? We have to be fully surrendered to the Lord. And God has to take first place. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And so knowing this, there needs to be a full surrender. And Paul was willing to surrender himself completely to the Lord. So he is fullness of the Holy Spirit, fully surrendered unto God. And letter C is just simply this: he flourished in spiritual knowledge. Notice in verse 22, but soul increased the more in strength, and confounded the Jews which dwelt at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. The knowledge that he had, the information that he was able to gain, fulfilled the challenge of Peter in 2 Peter 3:18, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And statistically, they say this, that the amount of people that read their Bibles faithfully before the pandemic, before COVID, literally, you would think, because of all the extra time people had, that the amount of people that read their Bible would go up, the percentage. But actually, the percentage dropped about 26%. People no longer read their Bibles. On an average, people no longer read their Bibles as much as they did before COVID. Now, you can't flourish spiritually based on the knowledge of who God is by abandoning the opportunities to read the Word of God and meditate on the Word. And so Paul flourished in spiritual knowledge. I want the Lord to give me wisdom. I want him to give me understanding. I want the Lord to speak to me. My message this morning, God just spoke to my heart about that phrase, there was a man. I didn't know there was that many phrases, was a man in the Bible. I just started looking them up. I don't know why I thought that. I don't know where it came from. But God gave me a message, and he ministered to my heart. I just shared where it says there was a man out of the New Testament this morning. There is a multitude of places in the Old Testament where there was a man that God would use in a powerful way. I just want to know if you're willing to flourish in spiritual knowledge, the way it seems like we're so pursuing all kinds of corrupted information and knowledge. And so 2 Peter 1:2 says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And so knowing that the grace of God can be multiplied, and the grace of God always brings the peace of God. And so flourishing in spiritual knowledge. Oswald Chambers said this. He said, there is nothing attractive about the gospel to the natural man. The only man who finds the gospel attractive is the man who is convicted of sin. And I read that quote. I thought, well, that pretty much sums up the whole situation. You present people the gospel of Christ. You tell them Jesus Christ died for you, was buried, and rose again. They're not interested at all. Could care less. The problem is the natural man. They're living in the natural man. And because they're in the natural man, they cannot gain an understanding or desire of spiritual things. Amen. Let me read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Paul says, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. And it goes on, he says, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. And so when you think about the spiritual understanding, a spiritual experience, you think about the impact of the gospel on the Apostle Paul. He was, listen, changed by the gospel of Christ because of the fact that now he's converted, because he was convicted of his sin. And as he's convicted of his sin, now he's looking at things through the spiritual eyes that God has given him, and not trying to make decisions based on the natural man. And so this matter of a spiritual experience, the power of the gospel is that it will enable you to have a spiritual experience. And I had someone this morning I was talking with. They didn't stay for church. They left. And but the fellow was saying to me, he said, well, I don't want to put pressure on you, but I need something from God today. And I said, well, I can guarantee you this. I said, I've been alone with the Lord, and I prayed, and the message I have is a message that God gave me very clearly. And so whatever he tells me to say is what God has for you this morning.
Amen.
And he didn't stay. He left. So I don't know what kind of a spiritual encounter he was wanting, but I can tell you this. We need to have a spiritual experience of meeting with the Lord like the Apostle Paul met with God on the Damascus Road. So I see a spiritual experience. I see a relational example. Notice that in verse 26 of Acts chapter 9, it says, when Saul was come to Jerusalem, he essayed to join himself to the disciples. But they were all afraid of him and believed not that he was a disciple. And so fellowship with other believers, right away he longed to be able to have that relationship. It was a strained relationship because they weren't ready to receive the Apostle Paul. They had heard everything that he had done. They had seen the believers that had been executed. And now this Paul is saying that he wants to come in fellowship with other believers. And they just don't believe that he is truly a disciple of Jesus Christ. Fellowship with other believers. I think that's why Paul would write in Romans 14:1, him that is weak in the faith receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. And I just know this. When somebody gets saved, they don't have all the right things to say. When somebody gets saved, they don't know exactly how they're supposed to conduct themselves. When somebody first gets saved, they're a babe in Christ, their life that they used to live, they just came out of it. Amen. And so when we receive people in the church, we're supposed to fellowship with other believers. We're not to receive them with doubtful disputations. I think that's kind of picking people apart and making sure that they cross their T's and dot their I's exactly like we do before we receive them into fellowship. And I know we live in a world, strange world. I understand that you can't accept everything that comes down the road. But there's a fine line here of recognizing that God has commanded us to have fellowship one with another.
Amen.
In Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but so much the more as you see the day approaching. There's going to be strange things happening. I'm going to tell you that right now. There's going to be strange people coming to Christ. And we need to accept them in by faith, believing that God has called them to fellowship together. And so this matter of a relational example, fellowship with other believers. There's friendship that was developed in verse 27. But Barnabas took him. I'm thankful for Barnabas.
Amen.
Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared unto them how he had seen the Lord in the way and that he had spoken to him and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. A friendship that is developed that is able to testify and give credibility to the faith that you have. What a joy it is to be able to have somebody to be able to come alongside of you and confirm the fact that you've trusted Christ as your Savior. Amen. That comes through developing friendships together. I tell you, I really love Bible college. All we do is preach and go soul winning and go to church and do ministry and do work in the classroom and have no time to sleep, no time for recreation, no money for neither. And but the times that we had when I was in Bible college were a high time of spirituality. And it was not because of the teaching that I received. It was because of the real friendships that were developed. As we would walk down the road of hallways and we would share prayer requests and we would go into rooms and we would pray. And I mean, prayer was actively alive.
Amen.
In our lives. Soul winning and leading people to Christ was actively alive in our lives. And listen, the testimony that we had with each other was powerful and life-changing to others. And I'm just saying, Paul had a friendship that developed with Barnabas that was unique and life-changing because it testified of the fact of what God had done in his life. And now Amos 3:3 says, can two walk together except they be agreed? And Barnabas was going to help the Apostle Paul connect with the other believers. You know, 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 14 speaks about fellowship. It says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? What communion hath light with darkness? But what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their guide, God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Paul experienced this matter of coming out from among the wicked and identifying with and connecting with the believers in the early church. He had a relational example that we can follow. He had fellowship with other believers. He had friendships that developed. And he had faithfulness to the Lord. In our chapter 9, in verse 28, it says, and he was with them coming in and going out at Jerusalem. I mean, Paul just got involved and connected with what God was doing in the early church. Relational examples. I tell people all the time, when I talk to my pastor, I felt God call me to preach. And he just told me, he said, Mike, get involved in the church. That's all you got to do. Just get involved in the church. Just start doing anything and everything that you possibly can and doing ministry in the church. Oftentimes people say, I really don't know if God's calling me. I don't know if God wants me to do this or that in my life. I don't really know what I'm supposed to do. Just get involved. Get connected. Be with other believers. Be a part of ministry together. And use the talents and gifts that God has given you. And you say, well, my life, what it was a mess. Well, every one of us had a life that was a mess. Amen. Nobody had a life that was a mess more than what the Apostle Paul's life was. Right. Yeah. But God used him and Barnabas connected with him. I like this. Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 6. It says, most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness, but a faithful man who can find. It's not about walking around boasting about who you are. I remember this fellow was in Bible college. Every time we had PE on Monday mornings and a personal evangelism class, we were required. We had to keep a report of how many people we led to the Lord, how many people we saw get baptized, and how many people we were discipling. And every week you had to turn a report. This one guy, every Monday, he would stand up and he was like, I led 100 people to the Lord at McDonald's this week. I never saw one of them go to church. Not one. I thought, where are these 100 people you supposedly led to the Lord? Amen. Some men will proclaim their own goodness, but a faithful man. He never graduated from college. He never went into ministry. See, there's those that will declare their own goodness. But where is the faithful man? Amen. Whether you lead somebody to Christ or you don't. Amen. Whether somebody recognizes you or they don't. Whether you're involved in doing the ministry and trying to help people and nobody is aware of it or not. Just be faithful.
Amen.
What God has called you to do. And so Proverbs 20 and 6 is a great verse. Proverbs 28 and 20. Says, a faithful man shall abound with blessings, but he that maketh haste to be rich shall not be innocent. And so, wait a minute, let's let God bless us and increase us rather than us Amen. Trying to increase ourselves.
Right.
John Wesley made this statement. He says, I want the whole Christ for my whole Savior. I want the whole Bible for my book. I want the whole church for my fellowship. And I want the whole world for my mission field. I read that and I was like, I like that. That appeals to me. I want the whole Christ. I don't want to miss out on one thing about Jesus. I want to know everything about Jesus. I want to experience everything that Jesus has. The Bible, the whole Bible, not just parts, Not trying to connect society and culture and this. No, I want the whole Bible to be my book that I live by. I want the whole church to be my fellowship. I don't want to be looking for fellowship with unbelievers outside of the church. My life is in the church.
Amen.
My life is with the church of Jesus Christ. I want the whole church to be my fellowship.
Amen.
And I want the whole world. When I walk out that door, I'm walking into a world that needs to be saved.
Amen.
And every person I come in contact with needs to know who Jesus Christ is. And so Paul had a spiritual experience. He had a relational example to follow, all based on the power of the gospel of Christ that changed his life. Then the last thought is this, is the evangelical endurance. Notice in verse 29 of our chapter, it says, he spake boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus and disputed against the Grecians, but they went about to slay him. I see, first of all, that Paul was fearless in his witnessing. We don't have time, but if you were to read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 21 through 31, you read of the Apostle Paul gives a resume, if you will, of all the experiences he had. Shipwrecked, left for dead, beaten, questioned, abandoned, you name it. Paul goes through this whole resume of things that he experienced as a believer. But he continued on. Why? Because he was fearless in his witnessing. It says he spake boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus. And so we need to be fearless to be a witness. And then he focused on edification. Notice in verse 30, it says, "And which, when the brethren knew that they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him forth to Tarshish. Then the churches had rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria." And here it is. Why did they have rest? "And were edified." Here it is. "Walking in the fear of the Lord." Walking in the fear of the Lord. Notice, first of all, that was reverence. They were walking in the fear of God. And Proverbs, let me just read a few verses. You can turn over there if you want, because I have them lined up so they're easy to read and go through. But Proverbs chapter 8 in verse 13 says, "The fear of the Lord," the fear of the Lord means to reverence the Lord. "The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the forward mouth do I hate." This matter of being bold and focus on edification. Edification comes when there is a fear or a reverence of God. Chapter 9 of Proverbs in verse 10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding." Proverbs chapter 10 in verse 27 says, "The fear of the Lord prolongeth days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened." Proverbs chapter 14 in verse 26 and 27 says, "In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life to depart from the snares of death." You kind of get the idea. If you really want to be able to endure as a believer in Christ, there needs to be edification that's based on reverencing who God is. And not only that, but he also, in verse 31, there's comfort. It says, "Walking in the fear of the Lord," and here it is, "and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, knowing that God is the one who comforteth all of us." And 2 Corinthians 1:4 says, "But who comforteth us in all of our tribulation, that we might be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God." And so Paul was able to grow, he was able to mature, he was able to endure because of a reverence for God and because of the comfort of the Holy Ghost. And then the outcome or the effect in verse 31 says they were multiplied. There's an increase. And so they were multiplied. All the way through the book of Acts, you see this concept that as they preached the gospel of Christ, people were saved. And people were added to the church. The church grew. And I just know this, that God can bless and will bless in a church that understands the endurance that is necessary to just keep at being a witness, keep at evangelizing our communities and our loved ones and those that are around us. I like what Hudson Taylor, a missionary years ago, said this. Hudson Taylor said, the Great Commission is not an option to be considered. It's a command to be obeyed. And so we need to keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing is getting people saved. This week we have all kinds of crazy things going on, all kinds of games and everything else. But that's not the main thing. The main thing is getting people saved and fulfilling the Great Commission. Hudson Taylor used to be Curtis Hudson, he used to be an editor of the Sword of the Lord, said this, the only alternative to soul winning is the disobedience to Christ. If God has commanded us to tell others how to be saved, then when we don't, we're disobedient to Christ. There is no other option. Either you're obeying what God has said or you're not obeying what God has said. The Apostle Paul's life would be changed and impacted because of meeting a resurrected Savior. And that change in his heart, in his life, caused him and enabled him to experience a move spiritually in his life that developed relationships and friendships that impacted not just those in the immediate area, but it all the way across Asia Minor as he would go on his missionary journeys and endure the struggles and the problems and the difficulties for one reason, to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what made the difference in his life and in the lives of others. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to be together this evening. Thank you, Lord, for the power of the gospel. It changed Paul's life. It changed everybody's life around him. And so, Lord, help us to connect with and focus on the power of the gospel to change our lives. And then, Lord, help us to effectively communicate that with others so that their lives might be changed also. We thank you, Lord, that we can lift up the name of Jesus. For it's at the name of Jesus every knee's going to bow and every tongue's going to confess. And so, Lord, I pray that we might present Christ and Christ alone. I pray for this week with VBS. I'm asking you, Lord, just give us a multitude of young people to trust Christ as their Savior. And so bless us now in this invitation, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a song of invitation. If you need to pray this evening about your life, the impact your life is having on others, as we're singing, why don't you come and kneel here and pray. If not sure you're saved, I'll be here down front, and I'll show you from the Bible how to be saved tonight. Let's stand and let's sing now our hymn. Thank you.
thank you, Lord, that we know as we open the scripture and as we share the gospel message, Lord, that it's not about us, but Lord, it's about the power of the message. And Lord, we're just trusting you, depending on you, relying upon you, Lord, that that power of that gospel, Lord, would just penetrate the hearts of souls this week, that lives would be changed. Lord, that those that didn't know you as Savior, Lord, would gloriously saved. Lord, we're expecting great things. And so, Lord, we pray for your blessing upon us, Lord. Use us in a mighty way, Lord. Lord, we count it a privilege to be the vessels by which you communicate the message of the gospel. And so, Lord, we pray for your blessing now as we're dismissed. Lord, give us safety as we travel home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.